3 of our Milk and Honey series, a series about money, milk and honey, all about money. And first week we talked about money mindsets and what your thoughts are on money. Are they healthy? Are they biblical? Or are they actually a little bit religious and not in line with the Word of God? And then second week, last week, Pastor Peter spoke a brilliant message on taming the monster. It wasn't a parenting series, it was a money series. And that was brilliant practical teaching about giving, about, let me bring back my memory, giving, saving and investing, right? And that was fantastic as well. And both those sermons are freely available on our website. So if you missed any of those, I encourage you to download that. Who went and filled up their petrol on Monday this week? Oh, look at these people putting the word into action. You would have saved 20 cents a litre. Well done. Fantastic. And today, I've left the last one, the most controversial and challenging one, to the very end. I'm speaking on the supernatural principle of tithing. And I'm actually really excited about it. Many, many years ago, I had a friend in our church, or a doctor in our church, who came up to me and says, "You know, Pastor, I don't think you talk about money enough. You don't talk about tithing. You don't do the teaching on tithing." And he said, "Is that because you're scared?" And I said, I think I am. I think I'm actually really intimidated by people going, "Oh, they're talking about money again." He said, "But you don't understand. Unless you teach the people the Word of God, they're not going to have God's full blessing on their life." So by your intimidation and your fear on teaching on this topic, you're actually holding back your congregation from the goodness of the blessing of God. Because I'm going to pray for you that you have strength and courage to preach God's Word without faltering to the left or to the right. And so, since that man spoke that into my life, I'll be honest with you, I'm not afraid to talk about money, ask for money, share about God's perspective on money, because it's actually so freeing when we realize it is actually in the Word of God. Yeah. And whenever I preach something that is slightly controversial, I always say, please don't shoot the messenger, right? Write down the scriptures that I'm about to give you, go home, do the study that you need to form your own conviction. Because really, I'm just the message man. I'm the delivery man. I'm the one just saying, this is what God's Word says. But if you then go home, apply, and make it your own conviction, you're not doing it because the pastor said so. You're doing it because you've allowed the Holy Spirit and His Word to shape a godly foundation in your life. Amen? And that's what we want. We don't want sheep that just follow what everyone says and does because, you know, our world has so many opinions. We don't need another opinion. What we need is disciples who obey the Word of God and put it into practice. Amen? Amen. You know, my story, I started tithing when I was about 15 years old when I actually got my first job. I shared this with you many, many times. It's when I became a birthday party clown for Leeming Recreation Center. Yes, your pastor was a birthday party clown. And boy, did I rock those red noses and frilly suits. And I used to do 45 minutes. I used to get all dressed up and I would do birthday parties. And they would give us, just back then, what was a massive $15 for that 45. That was like $150 today, way back when dinosaurs roamed the earth. And I remember, and from the first time I got that income, you know, we were taught by church and also by our family, that, you know, putting God first is really, really important and giving to the Lord. So we would tithe and that would be $1.50 out of my $15 would go to the Lord. Back then, I know that doesn't sound much, but that is a lot of money when that's all you're getting per week. And so the tithe is extremely precious and dear to me. I've been tithing long before I became a pastor on the church. In fact, I've been tithing now for 25 years. Ooh. So it's not just out of religion. It's not just because somebody told me something. It's not because it's just in the Bible. I have practiced this principle, and I can tell you it works. It works. It works. God's word is true. And if you obey it, there's great blessing. And when I first started tithing, it wasn't because I understood the revelation of it. I did it just out of obedience. I didn't understand the scriptures. But the more I study the scriptures, and I'm praying that for you this morning, that as we study the scriptures together, the Holy Spirit is going to rip open, like drop the veil, and we're going to see things so clearly that we each get a revelation for ourselves. Amen? So let's start off with what is a tithe. And I'm going to sit down today because there's quite a bit of scripture that we need to look at. The first one is, what is a tithe? Leviticus chapter 27:30 explains it really well. It says, a tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belongs. And that's the word I want you to highlight. Belongs to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord. So basically the word tithe literally means a tenth part or a 10%. And the scripture tells us that a tenth of everything that we receive, all our income, belongs to the Lord. See, some of us think when we tithe, we're doing God a favor. We're giving Him a gift. Actually, there's a difference between a gift and ownership. If, for example, I was feeling really cold today and I went to one of you and I said, can I borrow your jacket? And I wore your jacket, and then when it was your birthday, I decided to wrap up that jacket in beautiful wrapping paper and say, I brought you a gift. You would go, hold on a second, that's not a gift, that's just you giving back what belongs to me. Right? And so the Bible actually says that the tithe, the first or the 10% of your income, that actually belongs to God. Wow. It's not yours. The 90%, everything comes from the Lord, but when you give Him the 10%, the 90%, that He says, I want you to steward, that can belong to you, but the 10% belongs to me. And that's why whenever the Bible talks about the tithe, it uses two words. It says give or bring the tithe, or steal and rob the tithe. And whenever you read the word rob and God saying you have robbed the tithe, you have stolen from it, you go, whoa, that's pretty harsh. It's because in God's mind, that 10% of your income actually doesn't belong to you. It belongs to Him. All right? And so we need to understand that a tithe is 10%. And when I was younger, I was thinking, okay, so we basically give it to the pastor or whoever collects the buckets. And then what happens? When I was in children's church, I thought they literally put it into a rocket and sent it up to heaven. That's not what happens. That's not what happens. What actually happens? The Bible tells us that the tithe actually goes to the storehouse to make sure that there's food in God's house. Malachi chapter 3 verse 10 says, bring the whole tithe. Everyone say whole. Not part tithe. All right? Not some of the tithe. Not the tithe that you can afford. Not the tithe that you have left over, if there is any left over. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, which most scholars would say to you is the local church, that there may be food in my house. The purpose of the tithe is so that this spiritual house has physical and spiritual resource to bless those that are coming to it. You know, when I was younger, I didn't have too much trouble with this because, you know, we would taught at a young age in our family that because you're a part of a family, you contribute. Everyone in the family had to contribute. I remember my beautiful mom waking me up at 8 o'clock on a Saturday morning to help clean the house. Now, I didn't want to clean the house at 8 o'clock in the morning, but we were a family. And Saturdays was when the family cleaned the house. We had to vacuum certain things and clean certain things. That's just what families do. Families contribute. So I grew up with that sort of mentality, and I understood. I'm thinking, of course, I get to come to an amazing church. This is when I was younger, especially when I went to Life City and I wasn't on staff there. I would look at this amazing church that discipled me, that cared for me, that ministered to me. I'd look at the great ministry. I wanted to bless the pastor. I wanted to bless the church. I wanted to make sure that this ministry kept on growing, that people in the community can come and encounter God the way we've encountered God. I wanted to sow into a bigger building. I wanted to sow into missions. I just wanted to make sure the gospel went out. After all, if I don't put my part into it, then who's going to do it? I mean, we all have a part to play. Isn't that correct? That wasn't my problem. Do you know what my problem was? My problem was making sure I had enough of the pie left over to do what I had in my heart to do. So this morning, I got up really early and went to bake for you. Tari's going to help me. You didn't know I was a baker, did you? Nor does my wife. Everyone's got a set pie. It is basically your income each week. Your pie may look bigger, smaller, depending on how much you earn, but we all have a set amount. We can't pray for greater. We can't immediately change for a bigger pie. We may want a bigger pie, but this is what we all have been given. For some of us, it's $100. For some of us, it's $1,000. For some of us, it might be $10,000. But we have all been given an amount. And the thing is, once we get that amount, we need to distribute it through all the different things that we have been given responsibility to. So Tari, I want you to start off by cutting off a little bit. First thing that tends to go in most people's houses is for our home loan, for our rent, for our board, whatever it is. Tari, come on, Tari, we live in Perth, Western Australia. Perth, Western Australia, that's probably Adelaide. 4x2 in Perth is a bit bigger than that, I reckon. Yeah, and let's give this piece of the pie to the bank manager. In this case, it's going to be, of course, the lovely Rob Moffat, who works for some cop bank. There you go, Robert. Come and get your piece of pie. And of course, as we see that going, we all cry and go, bye-bye. And now all I have left is this. Then of course, I've got to make sure that the school fees are paid, the utilities are paid, the bills are being paid, gas, water. So let's get a bit more of that pie into that. Because after all, we need to look after our families. We need to be stewards. We need to pay what is that we have a debt. Who would like a piece of pie? Yeah, go on, Sean. I know you'd eat it. I know you'd eat it. You're not allowed to eat in the carpet in this new auditorium, by the way. Don't tell Heidi Moffat. I'm not even looking at you, Heidi. And then, of course, to look this good on a Sunday. You know, there's a bit of money for fashion, for haircuts. I don't spend money on haircuts, by the way. On shampoo, on hair dryers. I save so much money. It's called stewardship. I can give you the name of my hairdresser. All right? So, who's got lovely hair? Maddie Diggy. Hair envy to Maddie Diggy over there. So with that, there goes a little bit more. And of course, we've got groceries. We've got to make sure that our family's fed. We've got insurances to pay for. So let's do that really quickly here. We'll give that a little bit more there. Fantastic. Right. And then, who would like some utility payments? Eudora, look at you, you're looking so hungry there. Come on, Eudora. There you go. All right. And then you come to church, and the pastor talks to you about tithing, and you go, oh, of course, yes, I do love Jesus. I do think we should contribute. But now, what is left is just the scraps. It's the seconds. And so what we tend to do is we just take what's left over, and we give it to the Lord. But the heart's right, to some extent, right? We want to honor God. Of course we believe in tithing. We believe in sharing. We believe in giving. We're not selfish. We're generous. Thank you, beautiful. You've done a great job. Would you give Tari a big round of applause? But you know, there's a better way. In fact, the Bible actually says that type of giving doesn't honor the Lord. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 to 10, the Bible says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the, everyone say this word, first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing and your vats will brim over with new wine. You see, God says, look, I see your heart to give. I see your heart to budget. I see your heart to steward. But above every other priority, I must be first. He's not even afraid to say that. He's not even shy to say that I'm jealous for your affection. I want your first worship. I want your first fruits. I want your first finance. I want the first thought of your day. I want the first part of your affection. I don't want leftovers. In fact, the Bible actually tells us in Genesis chapter 4, when Cain brought an offering to the Lord, he brought just whatever. Abel brought the first fruits. Cain brought whatever. And what did the Lord do? He rejected a good offering. Because in the heart of Cain, God wasn't first. And you think, well, that's a bit harsh. But I thought about it. Do you know, Sharon doesn't want to be in the top five women in my life. Oh, honey, you're extra special this week. You're top three.
Yeah.
Slap. Isn't that true? Our partners want to be the first priority in our life. How much more a God that gave everything for you and gave his first and only son for you and I? And so we need to understand that to honor God, to truly honor him, you actually need to give him first. When I came across this principle, I had to change the way I tithe, because I get paid on Thursday, and sometimes by Sunday, it's the leftovers. It's the scraps. And so literally on Thursday night, Sharon and I, we give on Thursday night because we want the first thing where possible to exit our account to be the tithe for our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords. That's the first thing that goes out. And do you know what? What I found, when you actually put God first, his word is so true that he will totally bless the other 90% so that every other part of your life has more than enough to meet the needs that you would have, more than even what you would have had with the 100%. And so I think it's a principle that you and I need to understand. Matthew 6:33 puts it this way. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and then all these other things will be added unto you. Yes. You know, what we need to understand is that it gets harder to tithe the more you get. You know, when I started with $15, $1.50 wasn't a problem. But then, if you start getting a little bit more, you actually have to start giving a little bit more. And the real challenge comes in, and the real test of your heart comes in, when the Lord has been faithful and the Lord has already blessed you. Are you willing to give 10% of all the increase, the whole tithe in this house? You know, I had a businessman say to me, look, if I tithe my full amount, right? And you would understand. That's how much some people are earning in a whole year. That's my tithe. I said, you don't understand. That doesn't belong to you. That was God blessing you in the first place. It actually belongs to the Lord. The Bible says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse and just see what God does. The Malachi chapter 3:10, the Bible says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, but there may be food in my house. And then it goes on to say, test me in this. Everyone say the word test. Yes. Test me in this. This is the only time you are encouraged and asked by the Lord to test him. You're not allowed to test God on anything else except when he tells you you can test him. He says, I want you to know that the tithe is actually a test. Number one, the test is God looking at your heart to see if money has a greater position in your heart than he does. But the second one is you able to test him. Test him and see that he is faithful. And if he has promised you that he will provide, then you get to test him. And he promises that he will open the windows of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to even store it. Our theme this year, open doors. And when I saw this scripture, that it is the promise of the Lord that he would open the floodgates. I'm going to declare that as an open door. He's going to open the floodgates. But you don't understand the economy. You don't understand my job. You don't understand my career. You don't understand the threats. I get all that. I may not understand your particular situation, but my faith is not based on my particular situation or my particular circumstances. My faith is based on what my Lord has declared in his word. And he said, test me in this, Joel Chelliah, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing, so much, that you won't even know where to put it. That's his promise for every single believer. Amen. And so it's time for us to test God. When I first started our church, I did something quite brave. I actually encouraged people to do a three-month test. And I said, I want you to write your income, I want you to write your expenditure, and I want you to tithe for 3 months. And I want you to write any increased income or any decreasing expenditure, and I want you to table that at the end, and you will see, according to God's word, you'll actually be better after you have sown. And I said, if that does not work out, you have my full permission, according to the word, to never tithe again. And I thought, oh, actually, that's a bit silly, shouldn't say that. But can I tell you, he actually puts a test like that before you. And every single person who took that tithe test came back to me and said to me, you know what, Pastor Joel, I thought I couldn't afford to tithe, but now I can't afford not to tithe. Because of what the Lord has done. Can I just ask you, are the windows of heaven open over your life? Can I ask you, honestly, if it was to be honest, it's just between you and God, would you say, Lord, thank you for opening the floodgates of heaven? Or is there constantly a lack in a particular area? Maybe, not always, it could be because of stewardship, it could be because of wrong priorities, but maybe it could also be because you haven't honored God with the first fruits and with your tithe. Amen? Yeah. All right, now, some people might say, Pastor Joel, aren't you quoting a lot of Old Testament scriptures? Isn't the tithe Old Testament? Have you heard that one before? As though like everything in the old is now redundant because Jesus has come. For example, thou shalt not kill, redundant. You can do whatever you want. You know, thou shalt not commit adultery. No, because we're under grace, we can do, no. Some people actually believe that the Old Testament is completely redundant because of Jesus. Can I just tell you, that's a misunderstanding of scripture. All right, the things that are so dear to God are still dear to God today. Yeah. All right, but certain things have been replaced by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. But when it comes to the tithe, you need to understand that it actually did not begin in the law. It predates the law. About 400 years before the law of Moses, our father in the faith, Abraham, had an encounter with a guy called Melchizedek. Now that name basically means the son of righteousness, right? Or the king of righteousness. And he came from a place called Salem, which is the place of peace. So the king of righteousness, the place of peace, came and he had an encounter with Abraham and it literally transformed his life. A lot of scholars believe that this was a Christophany, a type of Christ experience. Abraham had a type of Christ experience with this guy Melchizedek. And Melchizedek, the first thing he did is he came to Abraham and he gave him bread and wine, which is symbolic of the communion, the broken body and the blood shed for us. And he gave himself to Abraham and he blessed Abraham. And the Bible says after that encounter, Abraham decided to honor the Lord by giving him a tenth of everything. The first thing you need to understand is if you're giving the tithe out of duty or compulsion, you've missed the heart of it. It actually is a response to an encounter with God. It actually is a response to the blessing of God on your life. It actually is the response to the transformation that Jesus has brought by giving his body on the cross, by shedding his blood on the cross. And when you get a revelation of how much he loves you and how much he paid for you to be free and how much he set you free from your sin, then the tithe, the giving, the gratitude just starts to bubble up naturally. And so this whole thing of the tithe, we can't base it on the law. We need to go back to its original form. We need to go back to its original sense and keep its original heart. 400 years ago, it was added in the law of Moses. And people said, well, of course, it's New Testament now. We don't need to look into the law of Moses. But you know, even Jesus in Matthew 23:23 had an opportunity to say, stop tithing. But instead, he didn't. In Matthew 23:23, when he is disciplining the Pharisees and the religious leaders of the time, Jesus says to them, woe you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites, you give a tenth of your spices, your mint, your dill, and your cumin, but you have neglected the more important matters of the law, such as justice, mercy, and faithfulness. And this is what he says, underline this bit, you should have practiced the latter, which is the tithe, without neglecting the former. He could have said, listen, you should forget the tithe and just practice justice, mercy. No, no, no. He says you should have practiced that, but you shouldn't have lost the heart for justice for mercy. All you've done is the duty of giving your tithe. It's a chore. It's a duty. If I don't, God's going to strike me dead. If I don't, God's not going to love me today. Listen, if that's why you're giving, please, please hear my heart. Stop. You have mistaken the heart of God. You are not trying to earn his love. You are not trying to earn his grace. There is nothing that you can do to make Father love you more. Yes. He has already given you everything you need to come into a beautiful relationship with him. He has already paid every price. He has already shed the most precious of blood. He has already crucified his one and only son. You and I cannot do anything to earn his love or gain his love anymore. But this is your opportunity to say, I love you back. I am grateful for your love, Lord. You see, the tithe is more about the heart than it is about the money. How do we know this? Because Jesus is sitting by and watching people put their money in the offering, in the temple. And all these rich people come and literally unload bags, drop them down, and they walk away. And then this poor woman comes and just puts two little coins in. And Jesus says, come here, disciples, come here, disciples. You see what she did? She gave more than everybody else. Why is that? Because when she gave it with a heart. She gave it, God, you are my all. You are my Savior. Are my shepherd. There is no one else that I will trust and lean on. And God says, that's the heart. When you bring your tithe every week, that's the heart. That's the heart I'm after. A heart of worship. As musicians, please come up and help me. And I used this analogy a few months ago, and in a moment our hosts are going to come. In fact, they can come in and serve us our communion at this point. But I used this analogy a couple of years ago about a man that was going away. I just want you to imagine if I was going away for a month and I picked three people. I'm going to pick Rob and Heidi. I'm going to pick Eudora because I gave her pie. All right, and I say to you, these three guys, saying, you know, guys, I'm going to go away for a month, and you know, Sharon is going to be alone, but it's going to be her birthday, so I'm going to give you $1,000 each. Now, all I want you to do is at her birthday, I want you to buy her something, a $100 gift. I want you to bring it to her. And all of them said, yes, of course, we'd love to. We'd love to. We'd love to. So I'm like, great. And then I go and then I ring Sharon on her birthday. Honey, how are you? She goes, oh, so good. How was your day? Oh, it was so good. You wouldn't believe it. I was just minding my own business and there was a knock on the door. And Rob Moffat rocked up. And he gave me a beautiful $100 voucher to Adair's, Sharon's favorite shop. I said, oh, that's so sweet. What a good guy Rob is. Oh, honey, you wouldn't believe it. It made my day. It was so kind. I'm like, well done, Rob. And she goes, and then, you wouldn't believe it, Heidi Moffat pops in and she gives me $200. Worth of Adair's bedding. This program is not proudly brought to you by a dentist. I can't think of any other shop Sharon likes. Smudge shit vouchers, I don't know. And I said, hold on, what did she give you 200? Yeah, she gave 200, and I'm thinking, I only told her she needed to give 100. Wow, she's a generous woman. I said, anything else? Anything else? Nah. Sorry, Dora. Anyone else call? Nah. Anyone else dropped in, wrote a letter, drove? Nah, nobody else. What about Eudora? Eudora didn't do anything? No, Eudora went on a Bali trip. She came across some money, God's really blessed her, and she's enjoying herself in Bali. I picked Eudora because she's the holiest. Sorry. Here's what I want to... How would you feel if that was you? How would I feel if that was me? Would I trust these three again? Well, two out of three, absolutely. Would I give more? No, because they haven't. The third one hasn't been faithful with the little that I've given. How can they believe or expect for more? See, what we need to understand, I purposely use that example, is because the church is the bride of Christ. The church is the bride of Christ. And as I would take it personally, if it affected my bride, you and I need to understand that just maybe we don't realize how personal the tithe is to the husband. And sometimes we get caught up, but today may he challenge us afresh of why we do what we do. May our giving be out of an overflow and not out of duty and devotion. I'm going to close with one last scripture, and that is Exodus 13:14. It says this, in days to come, when your son asks you, what does this mean? And he was talking about the redemption and giving sacrifices to the Lord. Say to him, with a mighty hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt and out of the land of slavery. What's this whole scripture about? It says, basically, one day, many, many years from now, your kids are going to come up to you and say, hey, Dad, I've just been looking through the books for the company. I've just been looking through my inheritance. I've just been looking through your finances. And do you know what? I just need to ask you, did you know that you are giving a whole heap away to the church? Did you know that you're giving like a lot of money that could be my inheritance, that could be for us? Did you know how much you're actually giving? It may have been a mistake. I understand like tipping God a couple, but do you know how much you're actually giving to the kingdom of God? When your son comes to you, when your daughter comes to you and asks you about this, what does this mean? You need to tell them this. That with a mighty hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt. You need to bring your son and your daughter in and say, can I just tell you a story that you probably don't know about? You don't know Dad's history. You don't know that Dad didn't always have all of this. You don't know that Dad didn't walk in the peace that he has today, in the prosperity that he had today. There was a time before Dad encountered the Lord where he was bound in sin. He was a slave to all forms of depravity. He was a broken person, but then Jesus came into his life and he saved him with a mighty hand. He picked him out of the miry clay and he set him on a rock and he blessed him and he healed him and he forgave him. And son, why do I do what I do? Because if it wasn't for him, I don't know where I will be today. Son, all that we have, daughter, all that we have was because he gave first. You see, sacrifice and giving is very hard when you lose sight of what Jesus has already done. But if you never forget what he did, giving is easy. Sacrifice is easy. Worship is easy. Some of us have just forgotten from where we have come. Would you stand in this place? I thought, oh, what a perfect way to end today with communion. I want you to remember how much Jesus gave for you and I today. I want you to remember The cup that is in your hand represents the blood that was shed for you so that you no longer have to live in shame, that you no longer have to be bound in sin. You no longer have to be dependent on any alcohol, any drugs. God can set you free. His blood was shed for you. That bread that's in your hand represents His body that was broken for you, that you can be made whole today, that you can have healing of mind, spirit, and body. It's powerful. Remember. Remember. Remember again. Remember again. Thank you.